Very good morning, my dear students. I am Dr. M.C. Natraja, professor from the Department of Civil Engineering, Ramaiah Institute of Technology, MSRIT, Bangalore. Welcome to session number 9. I will be teaching you the design of steel structural elements 18CV61. This is for 6th semester BE under outcome based education system of Visveshwara Technological University, Belagavi. Students, in the previous class I was discussing about the importance of plastic method of analysis, and also as a method we have seen the different theorems and also some of the important definitions such as plastic section modulus, elastic section modulus, the importance of shape factor, and also we discussed a few simple problems as to how the shape factor can be determined for rectangular sections and some of the other standard sections as well. Today let us continue with a few more problems on determination of shape factor, and let us take the example of a rhombus. So you can see how the rhombus looks like. As far as the sides of the rhombus is concerned, it is same. It is being taken as A. It looks like a parallelogram also, but the sides are being equal in this case. Kindly see, it has two diagonals. So one is the major diagonal. So this is what the small diagonal actually. The moment of inertia with respect to this is slightly more. And this is the major diagonal. So where the moment of inertia with respect to this is somewhat less, because the depth is more, but the width is less here. It all depends on how you are placing the section. Here the section is placed on its edge in such a way that the smaller diagonal is horizontal, so the vertical diagonal is somewhat longer in size. If this is what the question being asked, then how to determine the shape factor? Now kindly see the horizontal diagonal, which is having a width b. So with respect to this particular shape, the horizontal dimension is taken as the width, which is the dimension of the small diagonal, and what is this vertical diagonal? So that is having the depth equal to h. It is kept in such a way that b is horizontal and h is vertical, and you can also try this by keeping in such a way that h is horizontal and b is vertical. So whatever the way you do it, you are going to get more or less the same answer. Now kindly see this particular problem where the diagonal B is horizontal. Then what is the height of this particular triangle, the top triangle and bottom triangle? So we have two triangles in such a way that the center of the top triangle, the centroidal axis of the top triangle, is at a distance of h by 3 of the top triangle. So what is the height of that top triangle? The height of the triangle based on the entire height of the section, it is h by 2. And obviously the centroid of the top triangle, so it is 1/3 of its own height. So that is where 1/3 of h by 2, that is h by 6, comes into picture. So this is h by 6 as far as the centroid of the top triangle is concerned. And similarly with respect to bottom triangle also, we have the same depth, h by 6. So with this we'll be able to determine the shape factor. So what is the moment of inertia of the this top triangle with respect to the base? So this is what we have seen in the previous class also, and that is nothing but BD cube by 12. What is BD cube by 12 of the triangle? So this is B, and D is this one. So B into D cube, where D cube is h by 2 cube by 12. So that's what I have done here. The moment of inertia about z axis, as per the top triangle is concerned, it is b d cube by 12, and similarly b d cube by 12 for the bottom triangle. So therefore I z for the entire section about this. So we have to simply add in the moment of inertia of the top triangle and the bottom triangle so that we get the combined moment of inertia I z. So that is nothing but the simplification of this b h cube by 48. What is the elastic section modulus now? So the elastic section modulus is nothing but the moment of inertia Iz divided by the distance of the extreme fiber, the distance of the extreme fiber either with respect to the top or with respect to the bottom. So because of the symmetric behavior, so it is h by 2. So obviously z elastic is equal to, elastic section model is equal to, so iz bd cube by 48, so divided by the extreme fiber distance, that is h by 2. So if you simplify that, it is bd square by 24. So elastic section modulus is bd square by 24 as far as this section with this dimension is concerned. Now how to determine the plastic section modulus? So in fact we have seen a simple equation for the plastic section modulus with respect to this axis. So this axis being the equal area axis, top and bottom areas are same. So we need to take a by 2 multiplied with y1 bar plus y2 bar. So the total area, so you can calculate, and that total area is nothing but, kindly see here, half into base into height. What is half into base into height? Half into base into height. So this is the area, top area, or the total area by 2. So that is where you are going to get the area of the triangle. And then we need to take y1 bar and y2 bar. What is this y1 bar? So y1 bar is nothing but h by 6, and the bottom y1 bar, that is y2 bar, so this is also equal to h by 2. So with this, what is this? So this is nothing but half into the bh by 2 being the total area, h by 6 plus h by 6. Then if you simplify this, you are going to get bh square by 12. So bh square by 12 is substantially higher compared to bh square by 24 being the elastic section modulus. So plastic section modulus is always be more compared to the elastic section modulus. Therefore shape factor being the ratio of the plastic section modulus to the elastic section modulus. So that is equal to 2. So here we have 24 and here we have 12. So 24 by 12 is 2. So the plastic section modulus is 100% more compared to the elastic section modulus. The plastic moment carrying capacity when the section completely yields is 100% more compared to the moment capacity of the section corresponding to the onset of yielding. So that's what the interpretation of this shear factor. So you can also work out the shear factor for different sections also. So these are all very simple problems. So maybe at the end of the class, I will take this triangular problem, because it is bit difficult for average students, but otherwise for all other sections, we can work out. So please try to derive an expression for the circular section of diameter D. So the shear factor will be 1.7. And similarly for all other sections, I have just listed the value. For rectangle, it is 1.5, we have derived. For the square resting on one of the edge, it is 2, and we have seen for triangle 2.34, so we still need to see the derivation, and this you can work out. For circle it is 1.7, and if you have a tube of some diameter and with varying thickness, the value is 4 by pi, and if you have an I section looking something like this, it is close to 1.14. again, depending on the thickness, this value will change, and we need to work out these problems numerically based on the dimensions of the section. By chance, with the same I section, if we keep it in the form of a H section, so the value of shear factor is close to 1.5. so again, depending on the dimensions, some of these values may change, but otherwise for these shapes which are fairly constant, so the value is not going to change. And if you really want to derive an expression for the shear factor of a I section, so this is what the I section is. So one or two problems, if you work out, you will be able to understand how to calculate it numerically. And there is a very possibility that you may get one problem of this type in the examination. So it is a very, very simple problem. So the section, if you see, it is symmetric in nature. It is symmetric not only with respect to horizontal axis, it is symmetric with respect to vertical axis also. And in the steel table, so we have seen different types of rolled sections, ISJB, IS LB, ISMB, ISWB. So there are number of such sections available. So what I suggest the student is to write a very simple program to determine the properties of section, including the shape factor, so that you can generate whatever the information you have in a steel table. For all the I sections, all properties, writing just a few statements and solving those statements in your computer as a program, so the tables can be generated automatically. So instead of simply working out one problem, so kindly write the expression for the shape factor and work out all these properties and list it in the form of a table, so that you'll be able to appreciate. So this can be taken as a very small assignment, so where you will have an opportunity to use your Excel, and also the variation of these properties also you'll be able to plot. So something beyond what really happens in the classroom teaching can be explored. Now this is what the I sections, and kindly say you have a curvature near the toe and also at the junction. So this is what the radius at the root, and this is the radius at the toe. So you can neglect all these radius and you can find out an equivalent section or an idealized section. If this is actually the section taken from the steel table, so that can be idealized to this type consisting of three plates. So having a width of BF, width of the flange at the top, so thickness of the flange, and of course at the center we have the vertical web, and depth is from the bottom to bottom of the top flange to the top of the bottom flange. So this is what the depth of the web, but overall depth being H and the thickness being TW. So with reference to this idealized section, so we can work out the formula. So what is the plastic section modulus? So you know the plastic section modulus with respect to the horizontal axis, so that axis you will be able to see here. And A by 2, what is A by 2? The total area of the I section by 2. So that can be calculated, what is the total area. So the total area is, if you see here, so this is what the total area of the equivalent rectangle. So from that area, so we can subtract these internal two rectangular areas. So in that way, so you can get the expression for the total area, and off of that is the area of the top portion and the bottom portion with respect to this ZZ axis. So ZZ axis is symmetric axis, centroidal axis. So this is what the neutral axis of the elastic stress distribution. This is also the neutral axis for the plastic stress distribution, and if those sections are extended onto the cross section, again we have the same section, means so that is where we have lot of advantages whenever we have the doubly symmetric sections. So simply the horizontal axis passing through the centroid will be the axis for most of the calculations. Now if you take this ZPZ, so what is the ZPZ? So you can also calculate this ZPZ with respect to the major axis and also with respect to the minor axis by taking the top area A by 2 and locating its own centroidal axis. So locating the centroidal axis of the top T and then transforming that effect onto the centroidal axis, and similarly for the bottom. So we can also individually transform the effects of the top flange and the top portion of the web onto the centroidal axis, which is the equal area axis, and similarly the bottom two elements effects can also be transferred onto the horizontal axis. So that is what is being done in this particular equation. So kindly see here BF and TF. So this is what BF and this is TF. So what is this? This is the area of the top flange. And what is this distance? Kindly see, this is H minus of TF. What is H minus of TF? This is H minus of TF. So TF is this. So in other words, what is really required is we need to identify the centroid of the top flange, so somewhere here, and that distance with respect to the horizontal, with respect to the horizontal, and similarly the distance with respect to the bottom, so that being the same. So what is that we are doing is, so we are taking one area of the flange at the top and it into its distance, a similar bottom area into its distance. So that is where, so it is the distance between the centroid of the top flange to the centroid of the bottom flange. So with respect to that, BF TF into H minus of TF, so this itself will give you the transformed effect of the flange area at the top and bottom with respect to this. And similarly, we need to transfer the effect of the web onto the horizontal z axis. So has done it as a combination. So to take that into consideration, kindly say thickness of the web into h by 2. What is h by 2? So this is h by 2 means, so this is what the effect of the depth. And kindly see here, he is subtracting tf. So h by 2 minus of tf, if you subtract, so you are only going to get this particular depth. So that is actually the depth of the web to the top. So depth of the web to the top, depth of the web to the bottom multiplied by thickness. So that is what the total area. But we need the area of the web and the distance of its centroidal axis with respect to ZZ, and similarly from the bottom. So if you want to do that, it is simply TF into H by 2 minus of TF whole square. So this is what the formula we simply need to remember, so that the plastic section modulus with respect to horizontal ZZ axis will be able to calculate. Now if you work it out with respect to the vertical axis, even that axis is also a symmetric axis. So again, this is the equal area axis. And if you go by the same concept and simplify, so we are going to get this particular equation. So the importance of discussing this is to see that, so if you write a simple program taking these two things into consideration, and also we know the expression for the moment of inertia and the elastic section modulus, either with respect to the horizontal or with respect to the vertical, in the same way we will be able to calculate. So writing a simple computer program in C is always be easy. Otherwise, we can even use the Excel platform, because many of these things are in the form of a simple equation. So we can work out and get the answers for different sections depending on how you input the data, and some sort of a generalized analysis, some sort of a parametric analysis is possible, where the different properties will be able to list, compare and appreciate the problem. Otherwise, for any single problem with dimensions, numerical dimensions, we can actually work out as to what the shape factor is. In all these cases, the shape factor comes to about 1.1 to 1.15 because it is a I section. Now let us see in some of the simple problems as far as the ultimate load carrying capacity is concerned. So I will start with the problem number one. So this problem is already discussed in the previous class. So simply supported beam with a central concentrated load. So W is 4 MP by L, whether you use the static method or the kinematic method. And the same problem when it is fixed, the same problem, load is at the center, span L, the two ends are fixed. So we have seen that W is equal to 8 MP by L. So it is 100% more compared to the previous. Now let us take the third problem. It's again the simply supported beam. So instead of the load being acting at the center, so it is somewhat eccentric with respect to the center. But we need to know what is the distance to the left and what is the distance to the right. So from the left support to the load, it is A. From the right support to the load is B. And the load can vary such that A is equal to 0 and B can be L. So for any position of the load W, so we will be able to determine what is the load carrying capacity and how that load carrying capacity changes depending on the position. So that also you will be able to work it out. So as I mentioned, so writing a simple program and changing the numerical values and then getting the list of table, so where the W for different positions of the load you will be able to generate. So that always gives you full information as to how the load is varying. The ultimate load is varying depending on its position. Now for any particular position, so this is what the bending moment diagram at the time of failure, where the load will become ultimate. So what is the free bending moment? So there is only one bending moment diagram, the diagram with respect to the load, and the ends are being simply supported. There is no fixed bending moment diagram coming into picture because it is not a redundant structure. So it is a statically determinate structure. R is zero. Just one plastic hinge is sufficient to cause the failure by mechanism. And this ordinate is nothing but the maximum moment, and that maximum moment will become MP. And the same maximum ordinate in terms of load is nothing but this. So this ordinate as a load, it is WAB by L, and as MP, this is the ordinate. So if you simply equate these two things, so MP is equal to WAB by L. So this is what the value you simply need to remember in case of this type of problem. Otherwise, what is W? So W is equal to MPL divided by AB. The same answer you will be able to get even if you use the mechanism method. Now, after you analyze the problem based on the bending moment diagram, and the failure load is W, and the MP corresponds to this ordinate, and where that ordinate is corresponding to the point where the load is acting. And now if you draw the mechanism for this, it is quite obvious at the two supports, we have the two mechanical hinges, and obviously at the point where the load is acting, so you have the another plastic hinge likely to form. So two being the mechanical hinges and this being the plastic hinge, so all the hinges rotates at some point in time, so your structure fails in this particular fashion. So this is the B mechanism. Now we will be able to analyze this beam mechanism to get the ultimate load. Now what happens in this beam mechanism? So kindly see, if to solve this problem I need this displacement delta. So I have not shown the delta here, so this is delta. So this delta you can calculate as a function of theta 1, or you can even calculate it as a function of theta. So this delta is nothing but A into theta, otherwise B into theta 1. So what is the relationship between theta and theta 1? If the load is exactly at the center, so the two thetas will be same. But as you push the load towards the other support, where the B is becoming smaller and smaller, kindly see that particular angle is becoming large. And the value of A is increasing as far as the position of the load from the left support is concerned. A is increasing with respect to the center, but this theta is decreasing. So these are all the two things we need to remember, because whenever we draw the diagram, so we are not drawing the diagram to scale, so haphazardly we draw the diagram, but we also need to use your skill whenever you are solving the problem. So when you push the load either to the left or to the right, thereby the load becomes eccentric, so kindly say with respect to the smaller dimension, so the theta will be more, and with respect to the larger, the theta will be less. So you have some practice of putting the angle. So the angle which looks smaller out of these two, this appears to be smaller compared to this, I can make out from my eyes. So you call that as theta, so that in the event of you wanting theta 1 as a function of theta, so that theta 1 is always be greater than theta. So that is what you need to appreciate. But sometimes it so happens that we call this as theta and this as theta 1, where theta 1 is more than theta, and sometimes we call the smaller angle as theta 1 and the larger angle as theta, so theta 1 will be smaller. But as long as your calculations are correct, so finally the answer is also going to be correct. But it's always better to follow one particular principle, so that when you are calculating, so this theta 1 being the larger, because we have selected theta 1 as the larger angle, so this always be greater than 1 as far as theta 1 as a function of theta is concerned. Now with respect to this problem, so this delta is, so A into theta, so that's what I have written. So the delta is also is equal to, so this B into theta 1. So A theta is equal to B theta 1. So like this we need to form some relation whenever you are solving the numerical problems, which I'll be discussing later. So theta 1 as a function of theta is A by B theta. What is A compared to B? A is always be greater compared to B. So obviously theta 1 is greater than theta. So this is what the relation as far as this problem is concerned. We may be able to use theta 1 or straight away by theta, the problem can be solved. So the external work is nothing but W multiplied by this distance. So that distance, as you know, it is a theta. So that is also equal to b theta 1. So where the theta 1, if you replace this by a by b theta, still you are going to get a theta. So that is nothing but W b theta 1 is equal to W a theta. And what is the internal work? The internal work, kindly say. So that is what the internal work as far as this particular plastic hinge is concerned, where with the plastic capacity MP, so the portion of the beam will undergo deformation in such a way that the total deformation is theta plus theta 1. So otherwise, in a central position of the load, so we have taken theta plus theta into consideration because thetas are equal, but here it is theta 1 and theta. So MP is equal to internal work is equal to MP into theta plus theta 1. So theta is known, theta 1 as a function of theta is also known. So if you substitute that, it is A by B. Then if you further simplify it, so MP is equal to, so A plus B by B theta. So A plus B by B into theta. So if you further simplify this, so this will be MP L theta by B. So this is what the internal work done by the plastic hinge, but what the work done by the external load, so that is nothing but W A theta. So if you equate W A theta to MP theta L by B, so we are going to get W as MP L by AB. So in fact, it is the same thing whatever we have calculated from the bending moment diagram. So this appears to be very, very simple because the value of the maximum bending moment as MP is simply equated to the value as a function of load. So MP is equal to WAB by L. So straight away, so you'll be able to get the answer, and seeing is believing. So we will just has to write a simple equation of equilibrium. But when you're solving the problem by mechanism method, though you feel there is some confusion, but if you do not have the confusion and if you finally work out, so we are getting the same answer. Especially when you are determining the collapse load for a continuous beam where we have some numerical problems, so it is always be better to work out the problem as a function of the formulas derived based on the mechanism method. Now again, this is a propped cantilever. So this is fixed. Now this is simply supported. It is partially simply supported and partially fixed. So in fact, we have worked out this problem with respect to simply supported case, and also with respect to the both ends being fixed, we have derived the formula. Now here there are two triangles. So the first one is the bending moment diagram for the free load. So this, you know, the magnitude of the load is WL by 4 at the time of collapse. And similarly, here you have the maximum moment. So it gets accumulated here because it is a fixity. And this is the other support where the moment is 0. And we also know the variation of moment is linear, and that is where it is triangular variation with maximum moment and zero moment here. And if you superpose both, free bending moment diagram being positive, considered as positive, say here it is negative, and wherever we have the overlapping of the two moment diagrams, so it gets cancelled out. So the net bending moment diagram will look like this. So that is what the diagram I have hatched. And if you carefully observe the variation of the negative bending moment, so we have only this moment being maximum, and that keep on decreases and it becomes zero here. So being the point of contraflexure where the moment changes, and the positive moment keep on increases and becomes maximum here under the load, and then it decreases. Now we need to identify the value of the maximum moment from the free bending moment diagram based on the ultimate load. So that is WL by 2. Now if you see the variation of the bending moment, so this is what the variation from this variation, by seeing the geometry and then establishing the equilibrium equation. So the geometry is such that, so this EMP plus whatever the value of moment you have here as a part of EMP, so that you can calculate from this EMP. So if this is EMP for a distance of L, where this is 0 to EMP for L, what is the value for a length equal to L by 2? So that you can straight away calculate it as half of EMP. So if this is EMP, so this will be half of EMP. So by chance, if the load is still made eccentric, then I advise you to use the triangles, the two triangles. So if you see the negative triangle, for a length L, it is EMP. Now for length L by 2, what is this value? So it is MP by 2. So for any position of the load, by using this concept of using the similar triangle, so the ordinate where the overlapping of the bending moments comes into picture can be calculated. But in this particular case, it is MP, what you are seeing straight away, and this one, so from the negative bending moment diagram as a distance, so if you calculate, that is MP by 2. So with that, it is 1.5 MP equal to WL by 4, and that is equal to 6 MP by L. In fact, we have seen this answer to be 4 MP by L in a simply supported beam, 8 MP by L in a fixed beam, where the load carrying capacity of the fixed beam becomes double, 100% excess of load, because the two simple supports are converted as fixity. But here, if any one of the load is made fixed and the other one is kept as simply supported, then the load carrying capacity increases beyond that of the simply supported beam, so by 50%. So 4 MP is becoming 6 MP, and by chance, if you make the simple support as fixed, and 6 MP will become 8 MP. So thereby, the load carrying capacity of the member keep on increases even if you change the nature of the support. So whatever the answer I have got here from the static method, the same answer I'm going to get from the mechanism method also. So in mechanism method, I'll be writing the mechanism. So this is the deflected shape. When the beam is at the verge of undergoing failure, it looks like this. Initial position of the beam. So the W gets displaced by a distance called as delta. And kindly see here, so it is a simple support, so mechanical hinge. Mechanical hinge rotates by an angle theta when the beam is pushed. And similarly here, the plastic hinge is likely to form because it is fixity. Some portion of the beam with that plastic moment undergo rotation theta. So the rotation of the plastic hinge is theta, rotation of the mechanical hinge is also theta because of the symmetry of the load. And at this particular location near the center where the plastic hinge is assumed to be concentrated at a point, so the portion of the beam near the center because of certain length of the plastic hinge deforms continuously, where the total deformation with respect to its horizontal position, so this particular hinge undergo a deformation in this fashion. So because of that, the change in the deformation with respect to horizontal is this much. So theta plus theta, in this case it is 2 theta. You simply remember in this situation where we have a symmetric load where the two angles are theta theta, so the value of the moment is MP. So that is what the MP of the entire beam. By chance, if the MP of the entire beam is taken as 0.5 MP or 1.5 MP or 2 MP, so see that the entire MP, what is there in the problem, you put it here, and that need to be multiplied with theta plus theta. So with that, so the load W moving by delta, delta being L by 2 theta, so that should be equal to, so kindly see here, MP theta at this support and MP theta plus theta, so 2 MP theta plus 1 MP theta, it is 3 MP theta. Again, we are going to get the ultimate load as 6 MP by L. So it's a very simple concept. So you simply need to remember, so W is equal to 6 MP by L. So that straight away this answer will be able to use in case of solving a continuous beam where the end span of the continuous beam can be like this. So end span is simply supported, but this span is continuous. So this is one span, and if the other span is continuous, so we have the continuity situation where you have the moments to the left and right, and when you separate that, it is very similar to a simple beam with fixity at one end and simply supported at the other end. So the formula for ultimate load is 6 MPa L. And similarly, if you have an eccentric load, so kindly see there is a free bending moment diagram. This is the free bending moment diagram. And kindly see here, in the elastic condition, this moment is more, but this moment is less. But when you increase the load beyond, to ensure that certain number of plastic hinges are likely to form to cause the collapse, so there is a redistribution of bending moment taking place here. There is a redistribution happening. And which is the first hinge likely to form, and which are the hinge or the hinges forming subsequently, and at the time of failure, how the three hinges are going to form. So the theory related to this, you can get it from any good textbooks. I request the students to read the book to know how you are increasing the load gradually, so that the bending moment diagram is going to become like this. So the first bending moment diagram, the free bending moment diagram with the free value of the moment, this moment is equal to WAB by L. Only this ordinate as a free bending moment diagram as a function of the load is WAB by L. And now this entire thing will become MP at the time of failure as a positive moment. But we also have the negative moment coming here, that is taken as MP because of fixity. Here also it is MP. So with this being MP, with this being MP, it is again the same rectangle what you have seen in the previous case. So this is the triangle. Overlapping portion we are neglecting. So a small portion of the negative bending moment diagram to the left and similarly to the right. And of course near the center we have the positive bending moment diagram. Now what is that equilibrium equation we are using here from the bending moment diagram? Now kindly see at this point where we have the point load acting. So this is what the ordinate in the same way. So that ordinate is nothing but WAB by L. And in that, so this is straight away MP and this is another MP. So this is MP from the geometry because we have written this to be MP. So this MP plus this MP from the negative diagram and the positive diagram being 2 MP, and that should be equal to WAB by L. So that is WAB by L is equal to 2 MP and W is equal to 2 MP L by AB. So this is a very, very simple equation. Straight away you are going to get by simply seeing the bending moment diagram and ensuring that there are three plastic hinges and those locations we have MP. So MP plus MP is equal to WAB by L. Straight away the answer you are going to get from the static method. Now the MP is maximum here as far as the positive is concerned, and at any other locations along this length of the beam, so MP is always below. So we have satisfied the requirement of a statically admissible bending moment diagram where the moment is not more than MP, except at that location where it is maximum, I am showing one plastic hinge. And similarly, negative moment is maximum, I am showing one plastic hinge and no plastic hinge in any other position because MP is less. And similarly for this, so this is a plastic hinge. Now with these three plastic hinge, collapse mechanism is something like this. So being the beam mechanism. Now since the load is eccentric, so the delta is again different here. So see, when the beam is pushed by the load, so this is what the delta. So the delta is so small that the delta can be regarded as an arc of this particular triangle. So this triangle and the arc is assumed to be same. So this depth is nothing but A into theta. So this is also equal to this distance B into theta 1. So A into theta equal to B into theta 1. So what is not known as a function of theta, so theta 1, so that can be calculated. So A by B theta. Now what is the total internal work done by the plastic hinge? So there is one plastic hinge here, so MP into theta, and this is another plastic hinge. So the portion of the beam undergo rotation by theta 1. You know what theta 1 as a function of theta. So theta 1 is A by B theta. So MP into theta 1, MP into theta, and at the point where the load is acting, MP into theta plus theta 1. So that is what I have written. MP theta, MP theta 1 plus MP theta plus theta 1, and
taking theta 1 as a by b theta and this as a by b theta, and it is 2 mp l by b. So equate the external work and the internal work. So we have this equation. So theta theta goes to dots. So thereby w is equal to 2 mp l by ab. So what the formula I have derived from the static method, which is also called as the equilibrium method, the same value I am getting it from the mechanism method, which is also called as the kinematic method. Now let us go to the next problem. So this is the problem on simply supported beam but subjected to UDL. So kindly see what is that I have represented on the beam. Span is L, no change. This is what the intensity of the load. What is the intensity of the load? 2 kilonewton per meter. So the load should be kilonewton per meter. Whenever we have per meter, then it is intensity. And when you take the intensity multiplied by the span over which the load is acting, then it is the total load. So intensity into L is nothing but W. So capital W is the total load, put it as a UDL. Otherwise W is the same total load per unit length as a UDL. But I have solved the problem as a function of the, this is intensity, but as a function of the total load. So total load is W into L. So that is what you need to remember. So in all my formula, capital W comes into picture, which is the intensity into L under the working condition. If you multiply it by the load factor, if you amplify it, then it becomes the ultimate load, where that ultimate load is equal to intensity at the ultimate load into L. So with that, the bending moment value at the center for the UDL, so it is parabolic, and that ordinate is equal to W L by 8, where W is the total load. If you take the intensity, it is small W L square by 8. So that's what the formula we are quite familiar. W L square by 8, W L square by 12, W L square by 24. So many of these things you must have used in your RCC or maybe in your strength of material as a part of your numerical problems. But here it is the same W L square by 8, but W is the total load. So capital W L by 8. Now this is what the very simple bending moment diagram. The variation is parabolic, and this is what the ordinate of the bending moment diagram, and that maximum value of the bending moment will automatically become MP, and the equation of equilibrium is MP equal to this. So MP equal to this from the bending moment diagram, that's what I have written here. So with that, W is equal to 8 MP by L. So kindly see what is 4 MP by L. So 4 MP by L is for a simply supported beam, but the total load is put exactly at the center as if it is completely concentrated. So then it is 4 MP by L. So if you spread the load over the span as a UDL, then it is 8 MP by L. And in fact, so we have seen all these things, the advantages of putting the load as a concentrated load and putting the same load as a UDL. But if you put the load as a UDL, the load carrying capacity of the member increases. So the failure will not be at a lesser load. But if you put the load at the center, so even at the lesser load, the structure fails. Now let us go to the mechanism approach. So this is the beam mechanism. Now kindly see, so this is the deflection of the left support by theta, deflection of the right support by theta, the same thing, similar to simply supported beam. And here we are going to get the plastic hinge, and the total rotation of certain length of the plastic hinge is by theta plus theta, so we have 2 theta. No change in the mechanism, no change in the mechanism, and only one plastic hinge is likely to come. But what is important here is, kindly say, in the simply supported beam with a central concentrated load, the entire load was at the center and that load was being pushed by delta. But here it is that load acting as a UDL, but that load is assumed to be concentrated at the center. So the concentrated total load is pushed by delta, but the entire load as a UDL is not pushed by delta, it is pushed by the deformation, which is average of what the deformation you are going to get at this support being zero, and the load at the center getting deflected by delta. So zero plus delta by two means it is the average displacement. So the average displacement is delta by two. So in point load, so load into delta. So whereas in case of UDL as a total load, it is a total load into average displacement. So please remember this difference: concentrated load into delta. But here the concentrated effect of the UDL, since it is UDL, it is not the load into delta, it is load into delta by 2. So that is only the difference student need to know. So external load, it is W. Now kindly say what is L by 2 theta. So this delta is nothing but L by 2 into theta. But I need the average of 0 and delta, or simply delta by 2. So this is L by 2 theta being delta, and that delta by 2. So that is the reason I have put off here. So if you simplify this, it is W L theta by 4. Now at this location we have MP into theta plus theta, 2 MP theta. If you equate these two things, and your W is equal to 8 MP by L. So 8 MP by L is what the answer. If you have the load, put it as a UDL, but it's the same load. If you put it as a concentrated load, then the MP is, then the ultimate load is 4 MP by L. So 4 MP by L as a centrally applied concentrated load. When the same load is put as a UDL, so I will be able to apply almost 100% extra load, and that is where 8 MP by L comes into picture. So this is what the situation of a simply supported beam with UDL, and let us see what will happen if the beam becomes fixed, or even if the beam becomes, say, propped cantilever. So let us see the two simply supported ends becoming fixity. So that is what this particular problem is. But here we have two bending moment diagrams. Though there is no change in mechanism, go to the previous, no change in mechanism, same nature of failure. But still we have the same bending moment diagram because we have the UDL, but we get one additional bending moment diagram because of the fixity effect. And we assume that the moments at both the fixity is same, and that is where, so this is the negative bending moment, and this is another negative bending moment, and this is what the total positive moment, and the total positive moment is more than the negative moment, such that we have the net positive moment coming into picture. That should be MP, positive MP, and obviously this is negative MP. So that when you draw the diagram, you should see that the diagram is such that, so the free bending moment diagram is split into two parts. So one part to the top being the positive moment, the one at the bottom, which is the overlapping of the two bending moment diagram, is also being equal to MP. So MP plus MP being 2 MP equal to, so same formula, WL by 8. So what WL by 8 is equated to 2 MP. That will be equated to MP in case of simply supported beam, because there you had only one bending moment diagram. Here you have two bending moment diagrams, positive and negative, and when you see carefully the ordinates of the two diagrams, so WL by 2 is MP plus MP, so thereby W is 16 MP by L. So kindly look to the bending moment diagram. And with this condition, so obviously we need to have three plastic hinges. So this is MP, so one plastic hinge. So this is another negative moment, one plastic hinge, and this is the positive bending moment. All the moments are maximum being MP, and three plastic hinges are coming. So left undergoing a deformation of theta, right undergoing the same deformation theta, the central one undergoing deformation of theta plus theta. So with this, how the mechanism method works. So as far as the mechanism method is concerned, so this is not going to change. So this I have already explained in the simply supported beam. W getting displaced by delta, where delta being L by 2 theta, and I need the average delta, again that delta by 2. So that is where this off comes into picture. So the W L theta by 4, this remains same. And here, so this MP theta plus theta, so whatever you have as a part of simply supported beam, still you have it here. But here MP theta, MP theta. So MP theta, MP theta. Here MP theta plus theta. So that you are going to get MP 4 theta. So MP 4 theta equated to WL theta by 4. So W is equal to 16 MP by L. Now kindly say, what is this value compared to the problem number 9? So this is the problem number 10. So what is problem number 9? In a simply supported beam, it is 8 MP by L. Now kindly see here, it is 16 MP by L. So for a given beam of span L, whatever is the beam, any section for that matter, the MP value can be determined, and with that MP by L being constant, so the load is 16 times of that constant. In the simply supported case, it is 8 times of that constant. So when the beam becomes fixed beam, compared to simply supported beam, the load carrying capacity of the beam as a UDL is 2 times compared to the same beam when it is simply supported. But also we have seen, when the load is put as a UDL, this is what the situation, but when you put that load as a concentrated load, what is the W? It is 4 MP by L in a simply supported case, and when you make the beam fixed, it is 88 MP by L, where the concentrated load is acting. So that is where you will be able to make the distinction. And all these things I have put it here. Kindly say all the 4 problems. So get the feel of what these 4 problems are. The first one is simply supported beam with a concentrated load. The second one is fixed beam with a concentrated load at the center. The third one is simply supported beam with the same concentrated effect of the load, but put it as a UDL. So we have the total load, same W comes into picture, but here with the same load, the beam is fixed. So these are all the equations we have derived. So W is equal to 4 MP by L. If it is simply supported with a concentrated, then beam becomes fixed, it becomes 8 MP by L. So simply supported nature converted to fixed nature, the load carrying capacity becomes double. And kindly say, this is a simply supported beam, the same total load, you are putting it as UDL, and what is the load carrying capacity? 4 MP by L becoming 8 MP by L. So the load carrying capacity can be increased from this simply supported beam situation to this simply supported beam situation. The concentrated load at the center, if you make it as UDL, the load carrying capacity doubles. But if this beam is further converted as a fixed beam, then the answer is 16 MP by L. By chance, if a simply supported beam of some span for any given beam, if that beam fails when you apply a load of say 10 kN, just appreciate, you need to apply 20 for that beam to fail, provided the ends are fixed. Now, if you put the same load as UDL, but still simply supported, then also it takes 20. Put the load as UDL, make the two supports fixed, then it is going to take 40 kN. Is it that you need to have 10 kN of a load to be applied on a beam? Because you have paid some money for the beam. Beam of say 4 meter with some section say ISMB 400, you are purchasing from the market where you have paid some money. Assume that you have paid something like 10,000 rupees. So paying 10,000 rupees and applying a load of 10 kN and applying a load of 40 kN. So definitely applying a load of 40 kN is very, very important, but you need to ensure that the load is not put as a concentrated load, the load is put as a UDL. So that is the first thing. So in many of the designs, we assume the distribution of the load to be UDL. And at the same time, you should ensure that the two ends are made as fixed. So that's where the transfer of moment, you need to ensure it. When the beam is connected to any other beam or a column, how the connectivity is ensured. So that's very important. So proper welding or providing suitable number of bolts and all, if you do it, then the load carrying capacity can be increased up to 40 kN. So this is where the importance of taking these simple problems from the textbook to the field. So that's where you are seeing the engineering on the book, and now this engineering is transferred to the site where you are able to see these types of beams actually performing the intended function, and the load carrying capacity will become 40 kN compared to 10 kN. So this is what the practicality as far as the transferring of the design to field is concerned. Now let us take a few more problems. So now the time is 1:38, so we have still some more time available. So let us continue with a few more problems. So this is the next problem. So what is this problem? So this is a propped beam. So it's not a propped beam, it's a cantilever beam, because there's no support here near the free end. It's free end. So this is a fixity. Now in what way this problem is different? It is cantilever, but the span is L. The span is divided into two parts in such a way that, so from the fixity point, the depth of the beam is more, the size of the beam is more for a given width. So the depth is more, so obviously the moment of inertia of the beam is substantially higher. It is 1.5 times compared to the plastic section modulus what this particular section towards the free end is having. And also if you see the variation of the bending moment, even as a elastic element, so the bending moment near the end is zero, and as you go towards the support where you have the fixity, so the bending moment keep on increases and becomes maximum. So it is advantageous to provide a heavy section near the support, and as you go towards the free end, the section can be reduced. So that is what the advantage we are looking at. And kindly see, for 50% of the span, I have increased the section in such a way that it resists 1.5 times the moment compared to the moment carrying capacity of the portion near the free end. And kindly see, what are all the possible places of hinge formation? And hinge can definitely form here because it is a fixity. And also there is a concentrated load, but this is a concentrated load at the end where there is no moment likely to come. So obviously, even though it is concentrated load, the plastic hinge is not going to come here. And also observe along the length of the beam. So this is where the cross section of the beam is changing drastically from MP resistance to 1.5 MP. So plastic section modulus is changing drastically. So this is the location where the prismaticity is broken. This means a sudden change in the cross section is happening. So there is a very possibility at this particular junction one plastic hinge is likely to come. Now let us work out this problem from the kinematic approach. So one plastic hinge likely to come at this particular location. So where you have the discount, where you have the change in depth. So that's what I have put it here. And I'm not assuming any plastic hinge at this location. So obviously, so the left portion for a length L by 2 is not going to undergo any deformation. So that is treated as rigid. And one plastic hinge is assumed to form at this location. But when you apply the load 2W here, so the beam gets displaced by delta, and of course W becomes W. But you have only one mechanism where the projected cantilevering part of L by 2 simply gets displaced as a linear part by an amount theta, and the displacement near the support is delta. So this is what the entire mechanism, only one hinge is required to solve this problem. Then what is the second condition? So assume that the hinge is not going to come here, but the hinge is going to come at this fixity point. Means the entire length L undergoes a displacement in such a way that there is a rotation of theta, but near the end, the load is displaced by delta. So theta at this location and this being delta, and theta at the fixity and this being delta. So we have two mechanisms. One, a simple smaller mechanism, and of course a very simple, somewhat a bigger mechanism, but otherwise one plastic hinge in both the cases leads to collapse. So with this mechanism, so let us form the work equation, the principle of virtual work, so the kinematic method. So we have seen that. So kindly see what happens from the mechanism itself. W displaced by delta, W becomes WU, 2W getting displaced by delta. So delta is nothing but L by 2 theta. So simply put that equation, 2W delta where delta is L by 2 theta. That should be simply equated to, kindly see the number of plastic hinge. Nowhere you have a plastic hinge except at this particular point. So that portion of the beam with that hinge rotates by theta. So MP theta. Why it is MP theta? So you will be having a doubt, because this is the junction. To the left you have 1.5 MP, to the right you have MP. So whenever you have such a situation where at the junction to left and right if you have different MPs, so for the final failure the moment is governed by the lesser of the two. So thereby, whether this is 1.5 MP and this MP, or this may be 1.5 MP or this is MP, whatever is the situation, simply observe the problem and take the minimum of the two, either to the left or to the right. So thereby, at this location of the plastic hinge, it is MP, because we have a doubt whether we need to take the left part or we need to take the right part. With that MP, it is simply the rotation of certain portion of the beam by theta, that is where MP theta. So therefore, W is equal to MP by L. It's a very, very simple equation as far as the one portion of the beam towards the free end is considered. Now, when you use the second mechanism, what happens? So this is what the second mechanism is. So kindly see, it is again 2W being pushed by delta. So 2W being pushed by delta, I have written. That is where delta being equal to the entire length into theta. It's not like the previous one where it is L by 2 theta, but here the entire length into theta. So that is what I have written. So 2W into L theta, that should be equal to the corresponding MP of the hinge into theta. What is MP at this location? Go back to the problem and see what is the MP here. To the left we have a beam. So to one side we don't have a beam, onto the other side we have a beam where the MP is 1.5. so at this location, even if you observe, there is no two MPs coming into picture. In fact, it is only the MP of that part which is 1.5. so 1.5 MP into theta. So therefore, W is equal to 0.75 MP by L. So in the previous case where you have this mechanism, it is MP by L, but when you take this mechanism, it is 0.75 MP by L. So kindly say, it is the upper bound theorem, kinematic theorem. So we are forming the bound, upper bound to the failure load, means the failure load cannot be more than the upper value. What is the upper value? This is the upper value. Your failure load cannot be more than MP by L, but it can be less than MP by L. So that's where it is 0.75 MP by L. So you have two values, the upper value being MP by L, thereby it is the upper bound, bound to the upper value. But in such situation, we have the loads W MP by L, load 0.75 MP by L, which is the actual load or the true load causing the failure. The true load causing the failure is always be the least load. Since we have only two load, the lesser of the load is 0.75 MP by L. So the true load in this particular case, by using the kinematic method or the mechanism method, is 0.75 MP by L. So two mechanisms you need to work out: get WW and select the least load. By chance, in a continuous beam or any type of beam, so yeah, one more cantilever beam you can look for, where instead of having a stepped variation of the size, so one step you have, maybe you can introduce a two step variation or three step variation along the span. The span may be 5 meter. For every one meter right from the support till the end, so you can decrease the depth at some constant rate, so that you'll be able to see a stepped cantilever. So in such situation, so you'll be having two mechanisms or three mechanisms or four mechanisms depending on the situation. And also there could be any number of loads, but here only one load at the end is available. So by chance there could be one more load also available here, or I can also put one more load here. If I put one load here, so still the mechanism is not going to change, but this particular load is not going to be pushed downwards, because only this portion of the beam gets pushed. So with this mechanism, if you have a load here, that load is not getting pushed, so that particular load and the corresponding displacement being zero, we are not considering. Corresponding displacement means the theta still there, but the load is at this particular point, that is not getting pushed like this, so that load is not considered. So with this particular problem, suppose if you have a load somewhere here in between AB, exactly at the center, if you have, so the first mechanism, so there is no change, but when you go to the second mechanism, so 2W, again we need to multiply with this delta. By chance, if you have a load here near the junction, so that load multiplied by this particular delta being equal to this into theta. If I have one more load somewhere here, kindly say that load into the corresponding displacement, and that displacement being, so this distance into same theta. So as far as the second mechanism is concerned, whatever the additional loads, if at all you have on the same problem, so the corresponding load and multiplied by the corresponding displacements that need to be added, thereby the external work keep on increases, but your internal work done by the plastic edge, because there is only one plastic edge, that is not going to change. So with that, still calculate what is W, and the minimum value is what the total true collapse load causing the failure. But as I mentioned, whenever you have a series of continuous beam, still you can identify the mechanisms for the individual beams. Say there are four mechanisms, four individual loads, you will be able to get it. So see, where is the maximum load? So the maximum load and the corresponding mechanisms. So thereby you are forming a bound to the maximum load, means there is no other mechanism where the load can be more than that. All other loads are less than that bound value. But what is the true value? The true value is still the minimum of the four loads what you calculate. So thereby the upper bound theorem, the kinematic theorem analyzed based on the mechanism can be interpreted even when you are doing a problem. Let us see one more problem. In fact, it is the same problem. Instead of making the end cantilever, so you can also put a simple support, and thereby it becomes a propelled cantilever. We have seen the problem, and now this end is being made fixed. So kindly see, so there is no change, but here what are all the possible locations of the plastic hinge? So the plastic hinge will definitely come at this location, because there is a change in dimension. Fixity point, one plastic hinge. So here also you can get one plastic hinge. So obviously, so one plastic hinge here, another plastic hinge here, and of course you also get one plastic hinge at this location where there is a change in cross section. But where is the load acting? The load can be anywhere along the span. It can be one load or two loads or three loads. So you need not have to worry if there is a multiple loads coming into picture. So again, under all those loads, still you can have one extra mechanism. So thereby the number of mechanisms will be more. So, and again, we need to work out the loads, and finally the true load need to be selected. Now with one hinge at A and one hinge at C, obvious, and one hinge likely to come at this junction where the change in size comes into picture. So with these three hinges, so the mechanism is something like this. So this is quite obvious. Hinge with MP moment undergoing theta, this hinge with MP undergoing theta, and MP here undergoing theta plus theta rotation is what the internal work. Then what is the external work? So the external work is the load and the corresponding displacement. So why the mechanism is like this, why it is having a hinge at this point, it is because of change in length. This is what the mechanism I have identified, but there is no load acting at this particular point, but the load is at this point. So the load is now getting displaced by this delta. So load into delta, delta being, so this distance L by 3 into theta. So W into L by T theta, L by 3 theta is what the external load, and that should be equal to MP into theta. What MP? The MP at this location. What is that MP at this location? Go to your problem and see. So that is 2MP, because the section is not uniform, the section is varying. Here the MP is more, it is 2MP. So obviously 2MP theta I have written here. But when you come here, what is MP? MP, either MP or 2MP, whichever is minimum, obviously it is MP. That's what I have written here.
MP theta plus theta. But when you come to C, so what is MP? So there is only one portion towards the left. So where we have MP, MP into theta.
So 2MP theta, MP theta theta plus MP theta. So it is 5MP theta. 2 plus 2 plus 1, it is 5MP theta. Equate that to WL by 3 theta. So W is equal to 15MPL. Is this point clear?
Okay. Now when you come to the second mechanism. So in second mechanism, what happens? At the two ends, yes, you have the hinge, no doubt. But I am not putting any hinge at this point where there is a change in location, change in dimension, change in the depth rather. But I will be introducing one hinge at the point where the load is acting. But I have not introduced the hinge in the previous problem at the point where load is acting, because I need only three hinges to cause the collapse. But now I am assuming that the hinge can come at the point where there is a load acting. But I am not assuming the hinge forming at this junction where there is change in dimension comes into picture. So with this, I have more or less a similar type of mechanism. But the dimensions of the mechanism to the left and right of this plastic hinge will be different. Now as usual, I am calling this as theta. So if this is going to be theta, so what is this one? So this is theta 1. So what is this delta? Delta is nothing but L by 3 theta 1, which I have written here. That is also equal to this distance. So this is 2/3 of the L. So 2 by 3 of the L into, so this deformation. So angular deformation theta. So with this, theta 1 is equal to 2 theta. And also, my dear friends, kindly see what I have done here. If my beam is divided into two parts, and if I put a load at the center where the hinge is going to form here, the two portions to the left and right, so they are divided in the same proportion, 1:1. So it is same theta. But now if you see in this case, there is a load here, and this is L by 3, and this is 2 by 3 of L. So this is one part and this is two parts. So obviously if you call one dimension as theta, so another dimension will be twice or half depending on how it changes. Kindly see here. So this theta 1 is always be more. This theta is always be less. That is what you can make out from the diagram. So the ratio with which you are dividing the span is 1:2. So theta 1 is 2 times of theta. You please remember how many divisions you will be having as far as left and right is concerned. The left is one part, the right is two parts. So the left angle is more, the right angle is less. Obviously, the right unknown angle theta is 2 times of theta 1. So this also you will be able to make out by seeing the geometry. So now, so with this requirement, so if you calculate what is the external work, W multiplied by delta. So that's what I have done. The W will become W into delta. So that is equal to W L by 3 theta 1. And theta 1, as you know, it is 2 theta. So with that, if you simplify it, it is 2 by 3 W L theta. As usual, MP theta, no change. But here is, you have a hinge. Kindly go to the beam. To the left and to the right, it is the same beam. But MP is 2MP, so 2MP theta plus theta 1. So that is what you have to write. So this is MP theta and theta 1. So here this is actually theta 1. But now if you see this one, the moment is 2MP. So 2MP into theta 1. So that theta 1 is nothing but 2 theta. So here I think there is some mistake, so because of cut and paste business, so where I have not done this calculation properly. So don't worry about this calculation. So what is important is the answer. In this case, the answer is 7.5 MP by L. So sometimes we also make some mistake, but what is important is the concept. Please see the concept, I'll be explaining again. So this is MP theta. But when you come here, it is 2MP theta 1, where theta 1 is 2MP. So obviously 2MP 2 theta, it is 4MP theta.
and here it is mp theta, it is 5 mp theta, but when you come here it is 2 mp. So 2 mp theta plus theta 1, where theta 1 is 2 theta, so it is 3 theta. So it is 3 mp theta, 4 mp theta, 1 mp theta. So obviously it becomes 8 mp theta, and with that if you work out, it will be 7.5 mp by L is what the ultimate look. Now there are two mechanisms. One mechanism is resulting in 15 times of mp by L. The second one is resulting in 7.5 mp by L. So what is the minimum of this? So the minimum of this is 7.5 mp by L. So what is the true collapse load as far as this fixed beam is concerned? So it is 7.5 times the constant mp by L being the collapse load. So when you calculate this collapse load numerically, substituting the value of mp and L, so that need to be divided by the load factor. But if you apply that particular load, obviously the beam will undergo failure because you are analyzing the load based on the failure condition. So finding the load and putting that load back onto the beam, so your beam has to fail. But I don't want the beam to fail. The beam has to carry certain load over a time. That is what the design life of the structure is, which is 50 years. That's what normally we take. And for that to happen, where you want to use the structure for 50 years with that load being acting, the W need to be divided by the load factor. So the load factor in this particular case, as you know, it is 1.7, because we take the combination of dead load or even the dead load imposed load in such situations. So W divided by 1.7. So we are going to get the working load, which is a concentrated working load applied at the same location, and with that situation you will be able to use the beam for the intended purpose, and where the purpose for which you have designed, so that comes into picture, and the beam is performing all the intended purpose over the design time of 50 years. So this is how so we need to work out. So this is where a few more problems in that direction comes into picture. So now we are slowly moving towards the analysis of continuous beams. Now it is a two-span continuous beam. The span is more or less same. No change in the span. Kindly see here. So it is a span L, but I am putting a concentrated load at the center. And again, it is the same span L, but I am putting the load not at the center, towards the other end I am putting it. But there is a continuous support. I will introduce to the concept and I'm not going into the greater details, so you can still see this problem in the next class. But what I want to tell you is, kindly see the combined bending moment diagram. So this is a free, so obviously there is no moment. This is free end, there is no moment. The simply supported beam bending moment diagram. So that is where free bending moment diagram is something like this. As far as this span is concerned, so this is something like this. Now this is the point of continuity. So it is a two span continuous beam, continuous over the intermediate support B. The end A and B are simple support. Here you have the fixed moment. So one continuous moment to the left and another moment to the right. So thereby this particular portion B acts as a fixity from the point of analysis. So that is where you have MP coming into picture. So you put that MP here. So the fixed moment MP at B, and fixed moment to the left A is 0, to the right C is 0. So thereby you have one big triangle being the negative bending moment diagram, and two small triangles which represents the variation of the bending moment for the case of two simply supported beams, where the variation is linear. And this is what the net bending moment diagram to the left, net bending moment diagram to the right, and of course this is the negative bending moment diagram. So there is a overlapping, so which you are not considering, and those separate moments. So one is positive to the left, positive to the right, and of course the variation of the negative moment over certain length. What is important is to see the mechanisms here. So this is a simple support. This is a continuous support. I told you in a continuous support, there is a fixed beam. So from B to A, it behaves as a propped cantilever. So fixity comes into picture here, and of course a simple support, but the load is at the center. Mechanism is like this. So for this we have already determined as to what is the ultimate load. So please remember 4 times, 6 times, 8 times. So please remember that here it is simple support. This is not a simple support. If it were to be simple support, 4 MPa. Now since it is continuous like a fixed, it is not even 8 MPa. 8 MPa is for both the supports being fixed, but here one acts as if it is fixed, so thereby it is propped. So propped cantilever, propped beam, one fixity and another simple support with the concentrated load, it is W is equal to 6 MPa. So straight away we can write the answer, but this is the only mechanism we need to work it out, and that is what I have done here. So there is a fixity, so you have the moment coming into picture. The moment for the entire span of the beam is assumed to be MP, but here there is no MP because it is simple support. So MP into this theta, and of course whatever you have the MP at the point where you have the load, where the load pushes the beam by delta. So we have 2 theta coming into picture, one to the left being theta, to the right being theta 1. Theta and theta 1 are different because the load is not at the center, it is at eccentricity. To the left 2/3 times L, to the right it is L/3. So if you call this as theta, so this is theta 1. Kindly see the way I have written. So this is a smaller angle, I am calling it as theta. So the slightly larger value is theta 1. So obviously theta 1 is more compared to theta, but if you see the ratio with which I have divided the beam, 1:2, so obviously theta 1 is 2 theta. So what is the moment? MP into theta, MP into theta 1, MP theta theta 1. So theta 1 is 2 theta, so MP 3 theta, MP, what is this? So sorry, here MP is not there because it is a simple support, so I told very wrongly. So no MP comes into picture here, it is MP theta plus theta 1. So theta 1 is 2 and this theta 3 theta, MP 3 theta, and here it is MP theta, it is 4 MP theta. So I have this 4 MP theta being the internal work, external W into delta. So what is delta? Let us calculate from this side. So this is 2/3 of L theta, otherwise L/3 of theta 1, and you have to change the theta 1 to theta. So W 2/3 of L theta, with this W is equal to 6 MPa. So whether you solve this left part or whether you solve the right part, two mechanisms you are going to get 6 MPa and 6 MPa. So there is no different loads coming into picture. The true load is 6 MPa, and at the time of failure the entire two span continuous beam undergo simultaneous failure. So it is not that left will fail, the right is not going to fail, making the structure unfit, or the vice versa. But here the failure happens simultaneously, both the span fails when the load equal to 6 MPa is applied. But if you want to use this beam for 50 years, find out what is the working load that can be applied onto the beam from W. So W divided by the load factor, you get the safe concentrated load, and put that load and for that particular beam in your structure, so it performs all the intended function so throughout its design period. So this is how the plastic analysis of two span continuous beam comes into picture. So this is what the type of problems you expect in the examination. So still there are many more problems, 3-span, 4-span continuous beam with different combinations of the load, and we will see 1 or 2 such typical problems, and one problem from the point of how the design of a beam can be handled, even though it is not there in the syllabus. If you see the syllabus, it is only the analysis of continuous beam and there is no design. But bit of introduction to the design, maybe for a few minutes I'll be explaining, and with that this module 1 is going to be over. So anyway, my dear friends, so let us stop at this stage, and wish you all the best.